Nate. Good morning, everybody. Hey, listen, since it's campfire weather, we figured we'd do our virtual campfire here with the fire of the Holy Spirit to keep us warm. Wow. Is that a little cheesy? Laura's over here going, wow. Why don't you guys stand and worship with us this morning?
When you found me, I was so blind. My sin was before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness, you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercies and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul until the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. Grow. From the day you saved my soul. Oh. With a brilliant light is all around. An endless joy is the only sound. Oh, rest my heart forever now. Oh, in your arms I'll always be found. Come on. From the day you saved my soul, the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul. My love is yours, my heart is yours, my life is yours forever.
Come on, sing.
My love is yours. My heart is yours. My life is yours forever.
Come on, everyone. From the day, come on.
From the day you saved my soul. Hey, hey. Until the very moment when I come home, I'll say,
from the day you saved my soul,
from the day you saved my soul, until the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul. Oh, and from the day you saved my soul.
So this being our Campfire Sunday, we're doing sing-along songs. So I try to pick songs that all of us can do and sing really loud. So you guys are the worship leaders this week. Is that cool? All of us are in this together? All right, I love you guys. This is awesome.
For I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me.
I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You've been so, so good to me. And I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. Thank you, Jesus. You've been so, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming out. Come on. No wall you won't get down. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming out. Believe that, come on. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down. no shadow.
There's no shadow, you won't light up.
That's right.
Mountain, you won't climb up.
Come on.
Coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up.
Like, we're going to see. Oh, man. Isn't that good? And I heard y'all singing. I thought, I'm going to be right in the middle of them. Amen. It's going to be so good. It's going to be. And I'm going to sing like Laura when I get to heaven. Amen. So it might be a little weird, but just deal with it, okay? I just want to sing like Laura. It's fine. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you. I pray that you would continue to do this amazing work in Oak Leaf like you've been doing for years and years and years, whereby the world can hear this. It's not the overwhelming wrath of God, but the overwhelming love of God. God, help us to praise you. And in doing so, that fragrance of praise go out and help those who are smelling for the bread of life, and they could find it and partake and eat and say, wow, how satisfying. So good. You're so good, God. Thank you. Bless. As we dive into your word, do it again. Would you please, God, illuminate our minds, arrest our hearts, energize our wills. We'll be careful to praise you for it. We really will. You're a beautiful triune God, and we pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. And the people of God together said, amen, amen, amen. Hey, say something to somebody next to you like hello and good morning, and give it up for your band. Come on. There you go. Come on, give it up for your band too. You can do it. You're ambidextrous. Come on. I love it. I love it. I love it. Before I jump into the message, I just want to give some mad props to my brother Jeff Humphrey, who does so much stuff around this church. But he led an expedition of people to paint our walls in our church, and they knocked that out this weekend. So Jeff and your entire team, thank you, brother. Well done. I saw many of them in here doing it, and yesterday they made fun of me. I came in a little late. They're like, oh, just like a preacher to not show up for the painting. You don't want me painting anything. I'm so hyper. Paint would be all over your chairs. But it was great. They knocked it out. It looks so good. Beautification should be done, and it's awesome. And the Emory Room's done, too. Well done, Jeff. You and your team. Good job. I actually saw Brooke here yesterday with paint all over her. So well done, Brooke. I don't know where you're at, but God bless you. Amen. And it's good stuff. God's doing amazing things. I'm hearing wonderful things, too, that I'm most excited about. Somebody said, what are you most excited about that's happening at Oak Leaf Church at Home groups? I hear so many people giving me stories of how being in a church at home group invigorates their soul. And that is massive. That is so huge. So props out to all of you guys. I have a church at home group. Love going to it. I actually got a bonus about a week ago. Usually we meet on Tuesdays. Well, we had the chance to go back, and Wayne and Leslie fed me and my wife, and it was good. The only problem with Wayne is that when he gets to heaven, he's not going to be able to chill out. God's going to have him preparing the marriage of the Supper of the Lamb. Amen. The man will be busy cooking, and I'm going to be busy eating. Amen. Love you guys. So good to be here. I just want to also say, recently we had a meeting with the elders, and I am really blessed that I have elders who are my friends. And when I say that, I don't mean any of them are yes men or yes women. They challenge me, provoke me to godliness and living right, but man, it's so good to have friends. And I was just thinking of that this morning. I sat down here and listened to them as they get ready to do what they do to lead us in worship. They have a little moment that they shared together, and I was just thinking, wow, man, I have some pretty high quality friends, and I'm very, very grateful that God's brought them into my life. So amazing. You know, I always begin talking about every time I'm going to open up, you know, a message, it should come from the infallible, inerrant, inspired, authoritative Word of God. Amen. And certainly I have some opinions and some ideas associated with scriptures, but I've studied to do my homiletics and exegesis and do all that stuff. But then I always write in the top of my messages while I'm preparing, I write two words in the right-hand corner, so what? Y'all don't care how much I know. Y'all don't care what degree I have. Y'all don't care what Hebrew I've studied. Y'all don't care if I know the endings of participles in the Greek language. So what? Just want to make sure I've got my training and all that. What I write so what about is not that you would be pessimistic toward me, but that most people go, well, what does this mean to me? Can I just tell you, that is not a wrong question to ask. Because when Jesus came, every message he gave in that context. What is this going to mean to them? You know, he's super powerful, all-knowing. You don't get smarter than Jesus. And he came down and he said, I am a door. No, he's not. He's God. But he said he was a door because people understand doors. Oh, I go through here, enter into there. I know what a locked door is like, and a door is a gateway. Okay, I could. He said he was a vine. No, he's not. He's God. But they understood vines, and that from the vine comes the fruit. And oh, okay, get that. He said he was a shepherd. No, he's not. He is, all caps, God. But he spoke in such a language to answer the question of people that were listening. So what? What does this mean? How do I get it? How does this change me? And I love that. May the Lord bless and answer the so what today as we dive in. The Word of God says this, though, the infallible, inerrant, inspired, authoritative Word of God. Psalms 150 verses 1 through 6. This is closing out the biggest book in the Bible. And the biggest book in the Bible is the book of songs. Is God really in the music? Yeah, I think God's really into it. I think it matters. We don't just throw music in here because it's some little extra thing to do because it makes people feel a little certain way. No, it's actually a part of our spiritual formation. And if you look in the Bible, it is a big chunk of spirituality. And if you go Old Covenant, New Covenant, well, there's some things in the Old Covenant that doesn't happen in the New Covenant anymore, like killing the bulls and goats. Nobody, did anybody bring any today? No, it would be fine because I'd have Wayne kill it and cook it. Amen. Kill it, cook it. But we don't do that anymore. There's a lot of things that were a part of the Old Covenant, not a part of the New Covenant. One of the things that totally came over was this whole praise thing. Amen. It came over, and because of how God likes it, and I think one of the reasons that he likes it also is not just, he's not an egotistical God. He likes it because it's just right. It's like we see him, we're like, ooh, you. And he's like, you get that. They're good, good. Yeah, it is. Yeah, me. Yeah. But he loves what it does for us too. Did you know that God's a caring God? You know, this morning God cared about you when you woke up, and your eyes opened and you got up. I mean, he's dancing in heaven going, they're up, man. Look. Hey, let's bless them again today. Let's work in their life again today. They got a lot going on. Hey, Son and Spirit, let's remember them. Let's be involved in their life. We're helping them and all the host of angels. I mean, to think about that the God of the universe cares, that the God of the universe has your name on his heart today. It's a beautiful thing. And we, in light of that, praise him because he is good. Listen to what Psalms closes out with. This is so good. Praise the Lord. And I love all the exclamation points in here because I'm an exclamation point guy. Amen. Praise God in his temple. That's here. This is, we've set aside. This place has been set aside to meet with God. Yes, God's church is his people and the body. But there ought to be places that have been set aside that are sacred unto God. And in those places, we should worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's this piece of geography. Amen. Praise his strength in heaven. Praise him for the mighty things he has done. Emphasis on mighty. Praise his supreme greatness. Not that God's just great, right? Alexander the Great was great, right? Houdini was great. Tony the Tiger's cornflakes are great. But God is supremely great. Praise him with trumpets. Praise him with harps and lyres. You say, well, the lyres ought to praise him. I remember when I first got saved, I didn't understand Bible, and I heard that. Like, lyres? Good, I get to praise him because I was a liar before I met Jesus. I'm like, what is it? Then I understood what it meant. Actually, so we can understand this, a lyre is nothing more than a guitar, as we know guitars today. It was an instrument different from a harp. A harp is played by plucking, and a lyre is played by strumming. You just kind of everything. They said, do it with a lyre. Do it with the guitars. They say, well, we don't need guitars in the church today. Well, take that up with Jesus. Amen. Praise him. Listen to this. With drums. Amen. My brother was on that big drum box right there. Boy, Jason's just killing it today. That was awesome, man. I was loving it, boy. And get this. Oh, the Baptists are going to, you're going to get up and leave right now. Anybody with Baptist background, y'all be like, oh, there's no way that God said that. Praise him with drums and dancing. Yeah, there you go. Come on. Everybody's like, why are Dave and Lori so pumped up during the worship? They're just being biblical. Amen. Drums and dancing. Praise him with harps and flutes. Praise him with cymbals. And I love this. It's like God's like, oh, Tony's out there. Praise him with loud cymbals. I like that. Praise him with cymbals. Praise him with loud cymbals. I like that. Praise the Lord, all living creatures. And I love it. He closes the whole thing with praise the Lord. Love it. You know, we humans know a thing or two about praising. To praise simply means to express approval or admiration of. To commend something. To extol something. Praise. I have a little video that I made this week for all of us to enjoy. As we are about to watch this video, and y'all are going to get ready, and it has sound to it. Tom, thank you, guys. I want you to take in the sounds of this video. It's a little longer. This video and the other video, most of my videos, I try to be just about 1 minute long for my little attention deficit disorder person. But this is a little longer because we need to sit in this and we need to be convinced of this video, and then there's another video that's coming in a little bit. But I want you to really take in the sounds. I also want you to take in the movement that you see. Like, take it in, like what you're about to see. And I want you to take in the facial expressions of what you're about to see. We humans know a few things about praising. Enjoy this little video. Argentina, I've been there. To imagine that whole place full of those people. They had won the World Cup. They are going nuts. Humans know how to praise. It's just in us. They're approving of the soccer team. They're praising the soccer team. The longest ovation that's ever happened in the history of sports in America, this is the longest ovation ever given to Michael Jordan. I was going to make you sit through all of it. But 3 minutes later, 3 minutes, they give him a microphone. Look, shut these people up, bro. They finally did hush. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? The police can't even stop us from praising. They got to let the Beatles know, man. We love you, Ringo. Certainly wouldn't be Paul. Imagine if followers of Jesus were this unbridled with our prayer. These are Eagle fans watching their beloved Eagles. And the people go nuts. My favorite part's coming up. Doesn't even go to church. He's just praising God. She got a little excited. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. That's how it's done. Amen. That's how it's done. So let's revisit those verses again. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God in His temple. Can anybody praise God in His temple right now? Yes. Praise Him. Praise His strength in heaven. Praise Him for His mighty things He has done. Praise His supreme greatness. Praise Him with trumpets. Praise Him with harps and lyres. Praise Him with drums and dancing. Praise Him with harps and flutes. Praise Him with cymbals. Praise Him with loud cymbals. Praise the Lord, O living creatures. Praise the Lord. Amen. I love, love, love these verses. Amen. I love the admonition that he gives when he says, praise God for the mighty things he had done. Praise his supreme greatness. Interesting, isn't it? In the video, we saw masses of people praising other people who kick a ball, run, throw. They knock people down, football. Or the Beatles, they play songs. Or Tiger Woods hits a ball real good. Did you see what those people were doing? For those people that were just doing something with a ball? What they were doing with people that did something with an instrument? People going nuts. People going crazy. And if you look at the ticket that they paid to go to the Eagles game, then you know they're nuts. Amen. Going nuts. So to help us make great use of our time this morning, let's take in a few of the mighty things God has done. Let's check out God's supreme greatness. In other words, these are things that he has done. No one will ever do it. No one. He stands alone, unrivaled. No wonder the psalmist said, all the earth worships you and sings praises to you. They sing praises to your name. Selah, that means get you some of this. Wow, that's amazing. Come and see what God has done. So let's do that now. Enjoy this video.
What do lizards and Jesus have in common? No, it's not one of those offensive religious jokes. The only similarity between the two is that both of them can walk on water. In fact, the basilisk lizard is even called the Jesus lizard at times. This feature allows them to rapidly slap their feet against the water without breaking the surface, since they like to stay around water in case a predator happens to walk. Despite all this, we don't think these lizards can turn water into wine. Whether you've dipped your toe in the fountain of youth or cryogenically freeze your body, there's a very small small chance you can live for 1,000 years. Yeah, but the jellyfish has managed to find a loophole. The problem with old age is that our cells become too weak to reproduce, and then we die. However, the Turritopsis dorni has a life cycle that lets it revert back to its baby stage when severely physically damaged or starving. It goes back to being a polyp and starts its life cycle from there. If Frozen was an animal, he would be a wood frog. Frog has a very easy way of spending its cold winters. It simply hibernates in a hole it digs and then freezes its blood for months. As a result, these frogs can tolerate blood sugar levels 100 times higher than humans without any of the diabetic side effects. What's more interesting is that it can stop its blood circulation and restart it later without any blood clots, strokes, or even a heart attack. Flatworm. During the French Revolution, beheading was a way of killing off the bad apples. But that would not work with the flatworm. When you chop up these googly-eye flatworms like a scallion, they'll start to wiggle away from the individual pieces. The head and other parts just find their own ways, doing their own thing. And after 3 weeks, each piece will have a head and a completely identical body to the flatworm that was initially cut into pieces. Researchers are trying very hard to understand this process of regeneration and apply it to humans. Mimic octopus. Being one of the smartest cephalopods means you can outsmart your predators with ease. These eight-legged friends have color-changing organs called chromophores that act together to reflect the cells in a way to produce a body pattern that matches the surrounding. It's not just about the colors. It's also about matching their skin texture and body position to appear something they're completely not. They can mimic animals, plants, algae, and even rocks right to the last ridge. Don't complain to us when octopi take over the world. Sockeye salmon. Photographic memory is definitely a superpower, but scent-based memory is even a bigger gift that only salmon are known to have. These fish venture out to the ocean to explore, but always come back home. Since the ocean is huge, how do they know where home is? Unlike dory, these fishes don't need a map or a guide to remember home sweet home. They simply navigate their way back using the Earth's magnetic field. They sort of have a built-in compass that helps them find their birthplace. Bombardier beetle. Spider-Man can make webs from his hands, but can he make boiling acid bombs? Didn't think so. The bombardier beetle have a state-of-the-art defense mechanism that involves acid gas bombs. In extreme cases, where their life is in danger, they can make chemical bombs with a dose so lethal it can be deadly. The two compounds of the bombs are stored separately in the abdomen. They can mix the compounds on command, which results in a boiling mixture that explodes out of the tip of their abdomen. Since the reaction is exothermic, the heat release is enough to boil the gas up. Is there even a superhero or a supervillain that can match this beetle's power? Archerfish. What could compel scientists to name a fish archerfish? It's quite simple, actually. Their ability to shoot down their prey is what gives them their name. These lurking creatures wait for an insect on land to appear. And when it does, they squirt out a stream of water so strong that it hits the insect head on. Their aim is so accurate that by the time the insect falls into the water, they're waiting to gobble it up. You have to look at the fish in action, in slow motion, to actually see what's going on. In just a tenth of a second, they hit the prey and move to the spot where the insect is likely to fall. What's even cooler is that light bends all weird in water, about 25 whole degrees off. Yet the archerfish can make their aim, including all these calculations, to make sure their food is hit just right. Tardigrades. We've reached the strongest, most impressive creature of all time, who have managed to surprise all 5 mass extinctions. Tardigrades, also known as water bears, can survive extreme temperatures, extreme pressure, and UV radiation too. To top it all off, these creatures have been to space and thrived there. Their tactic is to shrivel up in a dormant state when conditions are less than ideal, while reducing essential proteins for their cells. Recently, a study showed one of the species using fluorescence as a mechanism to resist UV radiation. In short, there is nothing they can't fight.
That's exactly what I said all week long. And by the way, you can thank me because I actually looked at about 200 different creatures and I only shared about 14 of them, I think, with you today. All week long, Tammy called me to pray over me before I preached today. And she said, so what's, you know, what you been doing? She's out on a conference. I said, wait till you get home. I'm about to blow your mind. All these animals I've been studying all week long. Just, and she knows I do it all the time anyways. And I'll just stop my truck and get out and go, look at that butterfly. And it's, enjoy what God has all around me. Sometimes we get in our ruts and we just go to work, come home, go there, go there, go this, go do that. And we forget that the glory of God is all around us. And so we don't praise him much because our eyes are so focused on issues and problems and junk that we've forgotten to slow down and take our worship everywhere we go and let what's around us fuel our hearts for how magnificent and awesome God is. Amen. Like God did that. Like, no, God did that.
Well, I don't know, preacher, right now, you know, you're kind of rubbing up against my evolution.
Well, God bless you. I'm just going to let you know, I believe the Bible, God did that. Amen. God did it. It's amazing to me. God did that. And think about what we humans do. We love to go nuts for people who do great things. We do. But what happened to the church? What happened to us? What happened? Who infiltrated our buildings and went, keep it down? Who got in our life that said, no, don't get crazy about that? Well, hold on a minute. Don't tell me not to get crazy about something. I saw what you were doing about somebody who was kicking a soccer ball. Yeah, I mean, Argentina blew our minds through soccer, right? What God did with the octopus, now that's a shocker, amen. Are you kidding me? Well, good, I'm glad you could do that with a soccer ball. Did you see what God did with an octopus? Listen, see, you can't let it just hit you and roll off of you. You have to absorb. Did you see the octopus? Another fish came by it that was half color, and it split color in half. It's right there. And it's not David Copperfield. It's not Chris Angel. I mean, it's just an octopus that God gave these amazing powers that another fish can come up and the octopus goes, that's interesting. Poof. Look just like a. What in the world? That's amazing. Michael Jordan can throw a ball in a basket. They gave him a 3-minute ovation. Wonder what kind of ovation God has ever gotten. So what, Michael Jordan can throw a ball through the basket. God can create a jellyfish that doesn't need a casket. Come on, somebody, amen. Did you hear it? Did you know? I had to go check all kinds of different people this week. I was driving them nuts. All these people that are in infectious disease and all these other things. I'm like, but did you hear about the octopus? Did you hear about the jellyfish? What about the jellyfish? Don't die. What? Yeah, they do. They wash up on the beach. That's because they got caught in the current, but they're not going to die naturally. They just get younger. Well, who? I'm 58 years old, and I'm just now finding that out. What? It's a fact. Go look it up. I'm just telling you. It is amazing. And God did that. Like, God did it. God can do whatever he wants to do whenever he wants to do it. And he's worthy of our praise. And what I'm trying to tell you is we're looking at some greatly, supremely great things that God has done because it fuels our praise to him. Unbelievable. Well, Tiger Woods gets props through what he did with the club. I'm going to go ahead and say it, and rightly so. God bless him. Amen. Tiger Woods gets props through what he did with the club. God stands unrivaled by making an indestructible grub. What is that thing called? A tacker guard? What is that thing, that little grub thing? Say it again? What? Yeah, that's the easy way to do it. It's a water bear. That's what that is. Forget that Latin name. We can just call it a water bear. Americans did that, I guarantee you. That's right. American elementary kids did that. That's who did that. A water bear. What? I don't know if you caught it, but it's managed to escape 3 extinctions. Massive global extinction. The thing lives in minus 272 degrees. God did that. And then they hit it with radiation. I had to do a lot of study on that this week because it was blowing my mind. They hit it with radiation, and it will actually develop this chemical compound to keep the UV rays from destroying it. It creates chemical compound of sunblock. I needed some of that this week. Amen. It creates it. It's its own body. Then what? Yeah, God did that. Where is it? In outer space? No, it's here on the planet. God did it. You're a God, my God. He does that. He's great. He's supremely great. There's been other people who have made holes in one, but ain't nobody made a water bear. God. And sometimes we as adults, we just like telling those kind of stories to kids. Just the kind of, you know. But I think it would be good if we remembered it. We marinated in it. We absorbed it. God is great. God is supremely great. The Beatles, well, they mesmerized people as a band, but look what God did in creating, right? Creatures and the sky, sea, and the land. God did that. I would encourage you this week to take some time and stroll a little bit. It's springtime, weather's getting better. For a minute anyways, it's going to rain. Don't worry about it. It's going to rain again. God bless you. And whoever's praying for rain, please stop. Just stop. We don't need any more right now. Get out. Slow down. When the Bible says consider the ant, I bet that's not the only time that we should probably look at things that are out there and just remember how great God is. When I look at the ant, I don't think how great the ant is. I look at the ant and I go, God, you are so cool. You are absolutely. No wonder the psalmist declared this in Psalms 145, verse 3. Great is the Lord and most worthy of what? Say it again.
Praise.
Yeah, he's worthy of it. Not so sure that most of the things that get the roar from humans are worthy of the roar. I've been caught up in the roar. I remember one of the big moments. I was going to show you a video of it, but I was in Dallas, Texas. Somebody gave me some tickets to go see the Texas Rangers, and I went and saw Texas Rangers. And on this particular night, there's a guy by the name of Kenny Rogers. He's a left-handed pitcher for the Texas Rangers. He pitched a perfect game. And there was a guy that was playing baseball for the other team. His name was Bo Jackson. And this guy could hit a ball like, you know, to Jupiter. And he's so huge. And he struck that guy out too. And there was 70-something thousand people at this place roaring, like going nuts. There was an old guy beside me. And we're just like, oh, it's a perfect game. It's going to be perfect. I didn't even know what a perfect game was. I was just excited that other people were like, it's going to be a perfect game. I'm like, what's a perfect game? I don't even know. But man, 70,000 people just going nuts. The guy beside me, Tammy, was losing her mind because I hit this guy beside me like, yeah, boom. And he had fake teeth and his teeth came out. He's like, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yeah. He's like, yeah, I'll never sit next to that guy again. I love this. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness, no one can fathom. Like even in eternity in heaven, we'll never be able to grasp our minds around the full magnificence of God. It's going to take us all of eternity just to begin soaking in how great he is. Listen to what Isaiah said, Isaiah 25, verse 1. Oh, Lord, you are my God. And I say that to you, God. You are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name. Why? For you have done wonderful things. Wonderful things. You know, if you really take a pie chart and you think of all the bad things that have ever happened, and then you take a pie chart and you really look at all the magnificent things that happen every day, every hour, the good way outnumbers the bad. Way. If you put it on a pie chart, it's, and I should have done that for your deal, it's unbelievable how much good there is out there. But isn't that interesting? People that don't even know God, they'll blame him for the bad. And you saw in the video, I don't know, that kid probably did go to church somewhere, I don't know, but more than likely he wasn't holding the Bible in his hand, but boy, he sure was thanking God that the Eagles won, wasn't he? Thank God. And see, if we're going to blame God for the bad stuff, then we should probably even more enthusiastically praising for all the good. I don't know how many times your heart beat while you've been in this room, but God's given you every one of them. He's worthy of our praise. Wondrous things, magnificent things. He's worthy of our praise. He's worthy of it, and he wants it for you. He wants you to experience the power of praise. You do recall last week, if you were here, and if you weren't, I encourage you to go back and look at it on our YouTube Oakleaf channel. Praise, remember I said this, praise is a weapon for Satan to step in. Satan's on me. Praise Jesus. I don't mean praise Jesus because Satan's on you. What I'm saying is praise Jesus because he is. Praise Jesus. We saw a powerful story in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 that revealed this principle big time. Jehoshaphat is about to be in a massive battle against the meanest people on the planet that would skin people alive, leave them out there for days and days and days, and then they finally die just absolutely from pain. Then they would boil the people that they would capture, and then they would eat them in front of the other people. These Ammonites and Moabites were bad people, very, very bad people. The people from Seir, same, really, really bad people. They're coming after God's people. And remember, there was a scout that came to Jehoshaphat, King Jehoshaphat, and said, dude, we're in trouble. They're like right down the road. And so he prayed in publicly in front of everybody and just started praising Jesus, started praising God. And then when it came time to fight him, he didn't grab the snipers. He didn't grab the knife fighters. He didn't grab the infantry guys. No. He grabbed singers. He consulted with the people. Who can sing? You can carry a tune? Good. You're getting up in the front. What? Yeah. We're going to praise Jesus. What we're going to do, we're going to praise God. You guys are going to go first. The Bible says, as they were praising, some great things happened. Listen to what it says. This is so good. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And when he had consulted with the people, King Jehoshaphat, he appointed those who should sing to the Lord, who should sing praise, who should praise the beauty of holiness. I love that phrase. As they went out before the army and were saying, praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. Now, when they began to sing in the praise, I love that God let us know when he went to work. When they had began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who had come against Judah. And these are my favorite words, and they were defeated. Come on. You got a problem, get your praise on. You got a problem, get your praise on. Because there is power in praise. It provokes God to intervene for us against our enemy. That's how you make life amazing, through the power of praising. Lift up Jesus and watch God tear down your enemy. Amen. That's one of the reasons praising God wasn't one of the things that got dropped off in the new covenant. God's like, hey, let's keep that going. Don't you stop praising, because there's a lot of power in praising. I need you to praise me and keep praising me. I do something with it. I inhabit the praises of my people, and it moves me to move on your behalf. It is good. God wants us praising him. Listen to what Hebrews 13:15 says. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice to praise. Well, I don't know if I can go to church. I don't feel like it. Next week, I just might wake up and all the hell broke loose in my life, and I just don't feel like it. That's when it becomes a sacrifice of praise. You don't feel like telling God how good he is. You don't feel like telling God how in control he is. You don't feel like it. Everything around you says something differently. Past history haunts you. Some very bad things that have happened in your life, in my life. We don't feel like it. You're praising. And then it's a sacrifice of praise. And believe me, God understands how bad we feel. Jesus, Hebrews tells us, was touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And he praised the Father. We praise God. We lift up God. We magnify him. And great things happen. I love this. Offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. Amen. Well, I'm a Christian. I just don't share it with anybody because it's just supposed to be a private thing. No, in the name of Jesus, repent and openly profess the name of God. He's so worthy of it. Listen to this, 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen people. God picked you. Look at the person next to you. Look at him right in the eyes and say, God picked me. Go ahead and tell him. God picked me. He did. Go ahead and tell him. Tell him. You got picked by God. Oh, the octopus God? Put me on his team. Yeah. Yeah. That God did. That God thinks you're amazing. That God thinks he's crazy about you. Gave his only son for you. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You're chosen. A royal priesthood. If I dressed like I was, it'd be obnoxious. Could you imagine dressing like you're in the royal priesthood? Like, I'm just going to put it on, man. Come in. We're a royal priesthood. You see yourself for who you are. A holy nation. It's not talking about a country. This is talking about the heart of a people who are blessed by God, chosen by God, approved of by God. Of course you're going to be a holy nation. You're set apart. In what way are you set apart? To praise God. Look, it's right here. This is so good. God's special possession. Why? That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Why are you saved? Why are you saved and you haven't been struck dead and off to heaven you go? Because if you've got breath, you should praise him. If you've got breath, I don't feel like it, it's hard. Praise him. Give him glory. I mean, just think. You have to spend time thinking of his supreme greatness. You got to take time in your life to absorb his magnificence. And when you do, listen to me, you get caught up in it. You get caught up in it. Those people for the Eagles, they were caught up in it. Amen. The people at that one spot where Tiger Woods hit that ball, there's been so many memes created off of that thing. They were caught up in that moment. You get caught up in it. And you know what? Most people can't get caught up and praise to God because they're tangled up in their sins. And the tangle up isn't that we sin and you shouldn't. No, we're all going to do that. We're all going to think a thought we shouldn't have thought. We're going to say a word that we shouldn't have said. We're going to make a decision that we're going to regret. That happens. We're human. And as a faith family, we don't judge each other when that happens. We love each other in spite of it. We love each other and care for each other and help each other through. That's what we do. But why are we here? We're here to praise him. We're here to give him glory. We're here to just magnify God. It says right there. And remember last week we talked about who are we? We're praising God, but somebody's listening. Satan is listening. All the hosts of hell are listening, and they can't do anything about it. Why? Because we're praising God. We're giving God glory. This is so good. I want you to take a look at the screens. Look at this. You know what those are? Say it again. Say it. Say it like you mean it. Come on. Superfoods. You know what people tell me, I know because one of these people is my wife who's probably listening right now. I did not eat non-superfood while you were gone, honey. All right, I had fried chicken last night. Amen. Sorry. Yeah, I'm in the house of the Lord. You got to confess. She's listening right now on an airplane going, I knew it. I knew it. You know, you eat these foods, and it's proven, healthcare people and others and nutritionalists, they'll tell you. I mean, these foods will help your life. What you eat, remember when we were kids, you are what you, you put this in you, it's going to have an effect on your life. Superfood. You know that spirituality has a superfood? You know your Christianity has a superfood? Did you know that? What is that superfood? It's praise. It's beneficial for one's health and well-being. That's what praise is. It's a superfood for the Christian and the church. Superfoods are qualified by the results they bring. You can't just say you're a superfood. You have to be it. People experience it, and then the results show up, and they go, oh, that was beneficial for you. That was very helpful for you. Good job. Same thing can be said about this superfood called praise. Check out the results of praising. And I'm just going to go to one spot early in the church from where we get our whole foundation and our function, right? Enjoying God's love, sharing good news, doing good deeds, all for the greatest cause. Comes out of Acts chapter 2. Listen to what it says, Acts 2, 46 through 47. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. They must have got some recipes from Wayne. They were really happy there, brother. Amen. Glad and sincere hearts. Here it is. Praising God. See, we skip past that. Well, that's that little extra thing we do. No, it's the essential thing that we do. Praising God. And now look. And enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. What a benefit. Praising God results in harmony with others. The text says they were enjoying favor with all the people. Wow. Couldn't our world use a whole lot of that? These are just a couple of pictures on the screen. That's our world. That's our world. Those are events that have happened just in the last 2 weeks. Look at the anger. Look at the fire, the smoking, smoldering debris in the back because rioters are burning stuff. Picket signs, pointed fingers, fists, screams. teeth and they're not a smile. A world is void, for the most part, of favor with each other. We blame each other. We label each other. We compartmentalize each other. Even those who demand that you don't compartmentalize, don't you be racist. Don't you be homophobic. Don't you be blah, blah, blah. Don't you be. I'm finding that they in and of themselves have a whole new thing they're putting on you. It's called the don't you be's. Don't you be, don't you be, don't you be, don't you be. Well, get your finger out of my face. You keep telling me not to be something. It's like, who are you? You got some kind of, you know how everything ought to be, and you're just going to check off boxes if you go across everybody that you meet, make sure that nobody is this and nobody's that, nobody. No, 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 no. That is a crazy, our world is creating that world. That's the world we're going to live in. Just everybody measuring each other up. What about favor? What about being able to walk into a room and everybody's getting along, loving each other, caring for each other? Nobody's judging one another. Nobody's pointing at you because you do this or you did that. But there's favor, there's love, there's acceptance. Where does that come from? When you can praise God, it is easier to praise other people. You want to see the best in other people. I don't know where that happened in Christianity either. But for years now, for years, it's like the Christian eye is the judgmental eye. Are you a Christian? You know what they're saying? You're about to judge me. You're about to judge me. Well, couldn't something happen where the idea of a Christian is not that, but instead the idea of a Christian is, wow, that's that loving, kind, with me, for me, going to be here for me. Their tribe is going to help us. Yeah, let's go. And wouldn't that be amazing? Where does that come? When you're praising God. Because when you're praising God, you're giving an exchange. Yeah, it's tough for me, and those people hurt me, and that person hurt me, and this happened, and that happened. But I'm praising God. Then you extend to somebody what comes out of praising God. When God inhabits the praises of his people, that means God is inhabiting you with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Are you seeing it? How do I get it? Well, you don't get it by not getting it in you. You gotta intentionally do this. It's part of spiritual formation. That's the thing about praise. It's also one of the greatest evidences that validates the gospel story. Did you see it? The text says they were praising God, and the Lord daily added more and more people to the faith family. How? How did that happen? They learned an evangelistic presentation. They were training in apologetics. They studied harder and harder and got more and more and more and more books printed that were Bible studies. And let's just get more and more stuff in us. No, they were praising God. And when they praised God, there was somebody else that was out there all mully grubbing about life. They're like, wait a minute, you just had the same thing happen to you. You lost your job too. Why are you happy? Oh, that's not happiness. That's called joy. Well, where'd you get it? Oh, praising God. Oh, and it just showed up. Oh, yeah. In a bubbling brook that's exploding out of my soul. I can't shut up. Why is that not the norm in Christianity? Why is it something? Why would we excuse ourselves based on our personality? That's just not my personality. Wait a minute. It's shut up, Satan. It has nothing to do with your personality. The moment that you say, I can't praise a certain way because of your personality, you just confess your flesh is in the way. It has nothing to do with a personality. It has everything to do with a person who is supremely great. Hey, who does marvelous, wondrous works. And I'm telling you, when you get in it and you absorb it, this place, when you come in, you're going to come in here, you know what we're going to do? We're going to show you this great, amazing God. We're going to point you to this incredible, glorious, wonderful, marvelous, good, loving, merciful, you got to be kidding me, God. And when you see him and you get into it, you know what happens? You get caught up in it. And know what happens then? Other people want to get caught up in it. The Lord added when? Every Sunday somebody got saved. No, daily. Daily, out there, at the workplace, out there with the neighbor, out there on the street, God's adding people daily. Isn't that glorious? It was awesome. They hung out and praised God. They went to work, and God did what he does. He blessed relationships, and he saved souls. And so we got praising God. So powerful. Praising God is one of those things that shifts us. And when it does, it's our participation with God. See, you can't wait for some, like, everybody's like, well, God bring revival. And it's like people are looking for some, like, spooky poof moment from God. Like, we're all going to gather, and then poof, we're all going to start acting a certain way inside of a service or something, and then, ooh, revival came. Like what happened at a college recently, and what happened at another event before that, and somewhere else and somewhere else. I don't want to downplay some cool stuff that came out of that. But what is real? It's not God poofing in a moment. He's there all the time. He's already given us everything that pertains to life. There's not another thing he needs to give you. The Bible said he's given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. So it's already there. The issue is, are we tuned into the frequency? Have we been able to take the time to cut out the distractions and put on our minds the magnificence of God, the glory of God, the goodness of God, the greatness of God, pausing, sitting, taking it in like we did those animals, and just absorbing all of that and getting caught up in the wondrous glory of God. It has a way of taking us whenever we have things that are not our advantage, that have crippled us in life, have messed us up, problems, issues, our own shortcomings. It has a way of making those things kind of get dim, and God's bright in our lives and our hearts. You know, in the 1500s, England was a place where, I mean, just thousands of people lost their life because of faith, having faith in God. In the 1500s, it was pretty rough, that Renaissance time. Fox's Book of Martyrs captured the stories of those thousands and thousands of people that were martyred and killed like no other publication. If you've never read some of it, you need to read it, get past some of the King James-ness in it, but I kind of think it's kind of wonderful reading it that way. But there's one story that particularly marked me. I think I shared this story years ago here, a couple years ago. But there was these two guys, beggars. One of them was blind. One of them was crippled. That's in Fox's Book of Martyrs. You can check it out. They got arrested by the state church because they were singing and praising God on the streets. Why were they arrested for that? Well, then the church was the one that made all the decisions on whatever was taught and whatever was sung. They would only getting them the clearance on some particular song, and then you could sing the song. They had the authority to tell you whether or not it was theologically correct and if you could do it. And if you didn't, then they came and got you. And they did. They got both of them, and they had an inquisition. And they told them, you can't just make up songs like that out there on the road. You got to come through us. And they said, so we'll give you the chance to recant. And they said, for the love of Christ, we can't recant. We're just singing about how good he is, even though I'm blind, and even though, you know, I'm crippled. I'm just singing. I'm just praising him on the street. Well, when you say, you got to say that, you can't just say whatever you want to say. Isn't that crazy? It really happened, though. And then the team of people that were at this particular council or inquisition, they said, well, we don't know what it's going to be yet. Fire, disembodiment, impaling, but you're going to die. And so they put them in a dungeon. And for 3 weeks, they were in a dark dungeon with no light and no food. But the whole castle heard them praising Jesus the whole time they were down there. Just praising Jesus. Just giving God glory. Well, the day came for them to lose their life. They were summoned out of their dungeon, placed in a wagon. Off they went. And they could hear the crowd, you know, the blind guy could. They'd hear jeering people that had gathered to watch the death, just mocking them and screaming at them. But the blind guy still didn't know what way that they would die. He couldn't see what was going on. The crippled guy did. He saw the two stakes. He saw the wood that was piled up underneath it, and he knew we're gonna burn to death. And the blind friend pulled its cloak. So what have they decided to do? What have they decided to do? He hugged his friend. He said, they decided to give me some new legs and to give you some new eyes. They were tied to the stake. The wood was lit. And as their bodies were blistering and contorting in the flames, the blind guy was singing, with new eyes, I'm going to see my Jesus. The guy that was lame, crippled, he was singing, with new legs, I'll dance before my king. Could you imagine? It's documented. With new eyes, I'll see my Jesus. With new legs, I'll dance before my king. And then they died. Why tell such a horrible story? Listen, the record books give evidence of a massive, massive flood of people that came to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior in England right after that moment happened. Hundreds of people that watched and cheered as they were dying heard them singing. Listen to what they told the people who came after them. Here it is. Why are you now one of them? Said the executioner. Over and over, over and over, over and over, the testimony was this. These are the people that were there watching the blind man and the cripple. The God they praised in their death is the God who's worthy of my life. Would you stand with me? And that's so moving. The God they praised in their death is the God who is worthy of my life. Maybe you've been there. Crippled and blinded. Something happened in your life that knocked you off your feet. Maybe it was a former marriage. Maybe it was something with your extended family, possibly with your immediate family. Maybe it was something to do with your occupation. But life came, knocked you off your feet, sent you crawling. Or you got blindsided and it had you not able to quite see how everything's going to work out. We have our fair share of crippling and blindness that happens to us, do we not? I love the story of these two people. With new eyes, I'll see my Jesus. With new legs, I'll dance before my king. We got our eyes now, we have our legs. Let's praise him, amen. Let's give him glory. That's how we make life amazing, through the power of praising. Focusing on him, absorbing him, getting caught up in his wonder. And how amazing will it be when we throw off all the stuff that makes our praise stealth? Should never be stealth. Let's praise him, amen. Let's give him glory. Let's sing to him. Let's praise him in this moment. I think it would be the most supreme invitation that I could possibly give you is praise God and just get caught up in it. Know that as you do, he's out there working on your behalf. All that stuff that's happening, he's going to work it out. He's God. He can do that with those animals. Oh, he's got you covered. Amen. He is a good God. Father, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. Thank you. There is no God like Jehovah. We will worship you and magnify your name until it's all over, God. And thank you that you, who we praise, you are totally worthy of it. In Jesus' name, amen.
When Tony says, God's chosen you, I'm just going to be honest with you. I kind of look at myself. I'm like, of course he's chosen me. I have a little bit of an arrogance. And I need God's other messages to knock me down to where everyone else seems to find themselves sometimes. And there's a story about King David where he falls, right? We've heard the story, Bathsheba, and then he sends her husband away to die, and then he's confronted by the prophet, and in his repentance he writes Psalms 51, and in Psalms 51 he claims God. He's like, you're the truth holder, God, and make my heart wise to that truth in my innermost being. And then he writes this. He says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right, persevering, and steadfast spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold within me a willing spirit. And little did he know that 1,000 years later, Jesus Christ came to this earth to fulfill that prayer 100% in full. And in every single one of us, when we say clean heart, while David looked forward, we get to look behind and know that the work's been done. And we come before our Lord and say, just take my heart, Lord. Reset it to yours. Create a clean heart in me. Restore my joy so that I can have a willing spirit in worship. So this morning, we're going to just take a minute because I want all of us to have a willing spirit in worship. Yes, we've seen the evidence. Tony's, man, he's brought that. He's shown us. But I think before we need to get there, we need to have a willing spirit by having a clean heart. So we're going to sing this new song. Laura's going to lead us in it. And if you don't know it, man, just make it a doxology. Just make it a prayer this morning.
Precious blood has left me forgiven, pure like the whitest of snow, powerful to make sin and shame retreat. His covenant is making me whole, so I will rise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest net has set me free, because of Jesus my heart is clean. Purify my heart in your praise, teach me to discover the joy of holiness that forms as you draw me close. In you what was lost is restored. So I will rise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free, because of Jesus my heart is clean. So I will rise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free, because of Jesus my heart is clean. Because of Jesus my heart is clean. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up, until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life, you have been faithful. In all my life, you have been so. That I have is a hallelujah. just one move with my arms stretched wide. I'll worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah.
Let's pray and then we're dismissed. Lord, thank you so much for cleaning our hearts, making us ready to worship you. And Father, all we have is a hallelujah. We don't have much to bring, but we have our hearts to bring to you as a living sacrifice to follow the Holy Spirit, Lord, and that's what we want to do. We want to offer the best to you, and what we have in the best is to offer you back to you. So, Lord, we just thank you for the gift that is the Holy Spirit, the gift that is Jesus and the blood of Jesus Christ that covers and cleans us all. And, Lord, we just offer our hallelujah to you, not only today, but as we go out and we get into this world, that our hallelujah is heard by others. Our praise is heard by others, and they want to know, who are those Christians? Who are those kind of Christians? Who are those people? Lord, we want to be your magnification, not our own, yours. So, Lord, thank you for everything you do for us. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You guys have a great week. Thanks for worshiping with us.